Hi, Bernie. Thanks so much. You know, you can really call this the calm before the storm. The doors don't open until 6 o'clock, but fans have been outside since 2 o'clock getting ready for this much-anticipated game. Guess who else is ready for the game? Head coach John Beilein. Both teams coming off losses to unranked teams last weekend, so you better believe the Wolverines and the Spartans are going to show up and going to bring it tonight. We're live inside Chrysler Arena. Katrina Hancock. Bernie, let's go back to you in the studio. Hey, Bernie, thanks. You know what? We were all kind of holding our breath when Draymond took that shot, but ultimately it wasn't the game winner, and Tim Hardaway Jr. says he was so relieved.
We get that win.
You know, speaking of schedules, Draymond Green said in the Spartans locker room, no disrespect to Purdue, to Minnesota, or to Illinois, but now we have February 5th circled on our calendars, and that's because that's the next time the Spartans and Wolverines will meet on the hardwood. We're live in Ann Arbor tonight. Katrina Hancock, back to you. The Tigers winter caravan is rolling. I'm here live in Troy at Hockey Town Authentics, and the fans are waiting to meet Jose Valverde and Brennan Bosch. We're going to take you to three of their stops coming up next on Local 4 News.
You know what? I think both of these teams today looked ahead to Tuesday.
Well, maybe.
And not worried about today, which is not good. Yeah, both Michigan and Michigan State fall to unranked teams today. Plus, the ending to the Saints 49ers game was absolutely incredible. If you missed it, stay with us. We'll show you this instant classic next in sports.
Katrina, what happened out there?
8 students got sick yesterday afternoon, and then the sickness just spread like wildfire. Today, the interim superintendent said they have flu-like symptoms.
They start with a stomach ache, and it's very, very rapid onset. And then by the time they tell you they have a stomach ache, they're throwing up. Some of them, the parents have taken the kids to the doctor. The doctor says it's a flu.
How many kids were in your class today?
Like 8 or 9.
So were they all sick?
Yeah. There was like 17 people absent.
181 students and teachers were affected by this virus. Interim Superintendent Nancy Nagel has never seen anything like it.
It's just really unusual. We've had that concentration in that building. I've been here 13 years, you know, through a lot of the real serious flu things, and we've never had that many students out.
The custodian sanitized the entire building last night, this morning, and again after school today to rid the building of this contagious virus.
I told them to open up all the windows even though it's cold. So if it is airborne, you know, it has a chance to get out.
Because the virus spread so rapidly, Nancy Nagel did not close the school today. Richard Gray, a father of a 5-year-old, says he wishes something would have been done earlier today.
I've heard 180 kids out, and you know, if that's so, then absolutely I would think that they should have taken some action and tried to prevent that number from getting quite so high.
Sharon Stewart's 5-year-old grandson Jason is not sick, but Sharon's going to make sure he doesn't catch a thing.
Well, I just bought some vinegar. I'll take him home, bathe him, throw it over the top of him.
Okay, so Jason's not going to smell very good this weekend, but the good part of the story is that luckily no school this weekend, and so hopefully the virus will be out of the building by Monday. Live in Southgate, Katrina Hancock, back to you.
We are not going to pick nits. We are satisfied with a win.
I'm satisfied for a win, but I tell you, that last play has still got me. Oh, it was nerve-wracking. Yes. It should have been a blowout, but the bottom line is the Lions beat the Vikings and earned their 8th win of the season. We'll take it. First quarter, Vikings deep in their own territory. Cliff Averill going to come around the corner, knock the ball out of the hands of Christian Ponder, and Stephen Tulloch pounces on it in the end zone to put the Lions up 7-0. Later in the first, Lions facing 3rd and 14. Matthew Stafford going deep to the rookie. Titus Young has got it. Now run through. 57 yards on the score, 14-0 Lions. Still in the first, the Lions at it again. Stafford hooking up with Brandon Pettigrew for the 12-yard touchdown. 21-0 Detroit leading. Love that. Second quarter, the domination continues. Ponder picked off by Alphonso Smith for the second time today. This time it's returned 30 yards to the end zone. The Lions would take a 31-14 lead at halftime. That is the most points the Lions have scored in the first half since 1985. Wow. Third quarter starts with a lot of the same. Ponder back to pass, picked off by Eric Wright, but the return, Stephen Tulloch absolutely levels Ponder. That hit would knock him out of the game. So first possession with quarterback Joe Webb, 3rd and 10. He escapes the heat, takes it down the sideline, and nobody is in front of him. 65 yards to the house. The Vikings
pull to within 10. It's not over yet. Fourth quarter, the comeback continues. First and goal. Webb rolls to his left, finds Toby Gerhardt for the 2-yard score. The Lions' lead is down to just 6. After a lengthy drive that included 2 fourth down conversions, Vikings have one more chance to complete the comeback. Webb feeling the heat. What's going to happen? The ball is loose. Time is expiring. Cliff Avril, jump on it. Game over. The Lions would hang on for a much-needed victory. 34-28, your final. Want to know, so the Lions play at Oakland next Sunday. The Red Wings don't play again until Tuesday, but they might need some rest after scoring 7 goals against the Winnipeg Jets last night. In the second period, Johan Franzen finds Jiří Hudler as he's literally coming onto the ice. He'll beat the Jets and score his first of 2 goals on the game. The Red Wings beat Winnipeg 7-1. The Wings' next game is Tuesday night in Pittsburgh. And don't forget, we got Sunday Night Football, Giants and Cowboys.
Oh, yeah, that is a good one.
Down at Jerry's house.
Oakland, San Diego, Packers, boom, 11 wins, go to the playoffs.
I'll settle for 10.
Okay, 10.
That would be good.
That'll work too. Thanks.
Let's get Katrina Hancock in right now. And Katrina, a lot of information out there, but I understand that you just got a statement from family members.
Well, they tweeted earlier tonight. The problem of it was one report came out about 9 o'clock saying that he had died, and that is not true. And so luckily we do know the truth. He's alive. The internet has been buzzing all night long about Joe Paterno's health, but the reality is that right now Paterno is alive, but the 85-year-old is on his deathbed. Paterno's doctors say the longtime Penn State coach is in serious condition, and they've gathered his family around him to say their final goodbyes. Paterno has been suffering from lung cancer and has undergone chemotherapy treatments, but in recent days he's experienced some complications with his treatments. Both of his sons took to Twitter tonight to deny reports of his death. Jay Paterno tweeted, "I appreciate the support and prayers. Joe is continuing to fight." Scott Paterno, his brother, also said, "CBS report is wrong. Dad is alive, but in serious condition. We continue to ask for your prayers and privacy during this time." The bottom line is, it is better to get the story right than to be first. So what we do know is that he is in serious condition, and of course, we'll have more coming up in sports.
It's amazing what one false report will do. It just started that firestorm on Twitter and
online. It was crazy tonight. And you know what? We should not report anything that we don't know for certain. A friend of mine is a beat writer for the Penn State football team, and I contacted him tonight. He immediately texted me back and he said, "No, the report is not true."
All right. Okay. Thanks, Katrina.
Katrina.
Lots of rumors tonight surrounding Joe Paterno. At one point, it was kind of hard to separate what was real, what was fiction.
Right now, he's alive.
Right.
And that's what we know. CBS reported tonight that longtime Penn State football coach Joe Paterno had died. His sons immediately took to Twitter and denied the report. However, their father, alive, but in serious condition and is not expected to make it much longer. Tonight, Penn State students are gathering around his statue on campus in State College, PA. Paterno has been suffering with lung cancer, has undergone chemo treatments, and in recent days has had complications. Scott Paterno tweeted tonight, "CBS report is wrong. Dad is alive, but in serious condition. We continue to ask for your prayers and privacy during this time." Paterno, if you'll remember, was fired from Penn State back in November amid a child abuse sex scandal involving his longtime assistant coach, Jerry Sandusky. Paterno is 85 years old. As soon as we learn more about this developing story, we will bring you an update. On out of the ice, after a 2-game road trip, the Red Wings were back at home tonight hosting the Columbus Blue Jackets. The Wings earned their 16th consecutive victory at Joe Louis Arena, extending their franchise record. First period, the visitors up by a goal. Valtteri Filppula feeds Nicholas Cronwall, takes the shot, it goes in to tie the game at 1-1. That is Cronwall's 10th of the season. Second period, Wings on the power play. Nicholas Lidstrom, the shot from the blue line, bounces off the boards and the back of the goalie, Curtis Sanford, for his 10th goal. We're tied at 2-2. Now, it would go to a shootout. After 3 misses by both teams, Filppula takes the puck, rattles it in. That is exactly what we needed. Now it's up to Ryan Johansson and Jimmy Howard. Jimmy making the save. It's 3-2. Wings win, and they attack for Valtteri. Detroit has won 6 straight games, 4 of which have been in shootouts.
Sometimes when you travel and you come back, that game's always tough. It didn't look like we had great legs or great energy, and the mind was the same way. So we found a way to get a win and feel good about it. Move on.
Tonight at the Palace, the Pistons won their 4th game of the season, a 94-91 victory over the Portland Trail Blazers. First quarter, we're tied at 21-all. Rodney Stuckey says, "Get out of my face, I'm going to the rack." at the half. Pistons lead 54-43. Third quarter, Stuckey at it again. Shot clock winding down. Throws it up. That falls through. Stuckey finishes with a game-high 28 points. Pistons up by 16. But the Trailblazers fight their way back into it. Down 3, 4 seconds to go. Raymond Felton dribbles off his foot. That's the game. Greg Monroe loving it. Hey, a win's a win, right? Celebrate. Pistons on top, 94-91. Today in Fayetteville, Arkansas, the Michigan basketball team trailed the Razorbacks by as many as 20 points. Second half, Wolverines rallying. Trey Burke bringing it up. Jordan Morgan, hello, Rim. Wolverines down by 7. Morgan ends the game with 16. We got less than 4 minutes to go at this point. Burke on the move. Zach Novak is there. Toes behind the line. Bring it. 17 points, 8 rebounds for Novak. It is now a 2-point game. Same scenario, final play. Trey Burke, ball in his hands for the win. Not gonna go. Michigan falls to Arkansas 66-64. After dropping their last two games, the Michigan State Spartans were looking to get back on track today against Purdue. First half, Draymond Green going upstairs to Adrian Payne. Ooh, love it. MSU up 31-24 at halftime. Second half, more high-flying action. Off the Boilermakers turnover, Brandon Dawson. You better believe he's all alone. Bench loving it, 69-42 MSU. Late in the game, how about another dunk for you people? Travis Trice to the big fella. That is Dawson doing it again. Finishes with 14 points. Michigan State all over Purdue, 83-58.
If this team should get credit for one thing more than any team I've had in a long time, it's their unselfishness. My superstars are just as probably the most unselfish guys on the team. You know, the young guys are just trying to find what building they're in sometimes, but the other guys have been very unselfish, and I think that lends to everybody being unselfish.
Coach Izzo's pretty tough. University of Detroit Mercy versus Wright State at Callahan today. First half, Raiders turning the ball over. Ray McCallum gonna make him pay. Finesses it up and in for two of his 13, 38-25 Titans at the half. Then in the second, watch Chase Simons move right here, people. Oh my goodness, that's a thing of beauty. Simons for 16, UAD wins it. 69-53. Of course, when we learn more about Joe Paterno, we will update you on clickondetroit.com as soon as more information becomes available.
All right. Okay. Thank you so much for watching.
Brady now is down the field for the long ball. Brady tries it and strikes.
Tom Brady tortures Tim Tebow, and the defending Super Bowl champions are tested.
10-point game at the half.
Todd Bertuzzi gives the Wings another win at home. Thomas Holmstrom gives 600 children some life lessons.
If you don't talk about it, you know, they're not going to be aware of it.
Both Michigan and Michigan State fall short to unranked teams. The Pistons try to make it 2 in a row.
Welcome to Progressive Field.
How about an outdoor hockey game for the Wolverines and Buckeyes? Take a seat.
Dressed inappropriately for the bench.
Sports Final Edition starts now.
I still don't know how those two guys got on the Mavericks bench. Hello and welcome to Sports Final Edition. I'm Katrina Hancock. Thanks so much for staying up late with us. For all of you that wanted to see the Saints play the Packers in the NFC Championship game, I'm sorry, it's not going to happen. The G-Men went to Lambeau Field today and melted the cheese. A 3-3 game with less than 4 minutes to play. Eli Manning has all kinds of time to pass. He's got Hakeem Nicks, middle of the field. He avoids being tackled and heads for the hills. Nicks puts on the afterburners and is gone for the 66-yard touchdown. Giants up 10-3. 6 seconds left in the half. Eli Manning has one more pass in him, and it's going to the end zone. Hakeem Nicks coming down with it. That is a 37-yard touchdown catch. His teammate Victor Cruz in his wheelhouse at the half. New York leading 20-10. Middle of the fourth quarter, though, the Packers need to put together a drive. Aaron Rodgers finds Ryan Grant, but watch. He is stripped of the ball right there, and that's a fumble. The refs don't blow the whistle. Chase Blackburn picks up the ball, keeps it going towards the end zone. He'd be tackled at the 4-yard line. Very next play, Eli Manning throwing a laser to former Michigan receiver Mario Manningham, and that would seal the game. The Giants are moving on thanks to a 37-20 victory over the Packers. Look who is here to break these games down for us. Lomas, I cannot believe the G-men showed up.
Yes, they did. Wow. I mean, they showed up, and those guys from New York, they made me proud, and they got the job done. Those guys did what they had to do, which was to control the line of scrimmage. They got to Aaron Rodgers early and often. They forced them into mistakes. They turned the ball over a lot, Green Bay did, and it cost them.
Why couldn't the receivers catch the ball? Well, I didn't understand that at all.
It seemed like they were out of rhythm. It really did. And that's what happens when you get in the playoffs. Anytime you have a layoff, the playoff level is just so much higher than regular season to when you get into a game. If you're not on the same beat, if you're not on the same accord, you have drops and you have turnovers.
So he shouldn't have rested them.
I know. It seems that way. I'm telling you, you could always come back and second guess that, but it sure seemed like they should have kept playing.
The finish to the Saints 49ers game was unbelievable. We thought this game was over like twice.
Yeah, we did. I mean, to me, I think that might have been the greatest finish to an NFL game that I at least ever seen. I mean, it was awesome. It was back and forth, two intense teams, two offenses going right at it. And you could see when guys are on the same accord and when they're in sync, it's magical to watch. And that was a great game.
Vernon Davis's catch. Best.
I mean, it kind of reminded me of T.O. when T.O. caught the ball some years ago. It was awesome. And you know what I love the most? The emotion. Just the emotion of the moment for him. It was breathtaking. And again, it was quite a game.
Who goes to the Super Bowl from the NFC? 49ers or Giants?
You know, I'm looking at the G-men. I really think they have the combination. The two things you need to be able to do in the playoffs is run the ball and get to the passer. And they do both. Their defensive line is playing outstanding right now, and they got Brandon Jacobs and Lamar Bradshaw back there pounding that ball.
Tim Tebow time. Wow. Hey. Tom Brady.
Oh, my
goodness.
He said,
you know what? All of you be quiet. I'm going to go ahead and tie that NFL record with six touchdowns. And to Rob Gronkowski, he had three. Whoa.
I mean, it just looked like it was just pitch and catch for Tom Brady. You talking about taking your game to another level? Wow. This guy took his game to a phenomenal level. Tom Brady, five touchdowns in one half. He was picking the defense apart. He got his tight ends involved in the game early and often. And it made a big difference. Denver had no answer.
Answer at all. And today, the Texans really gave the Ravens a better game than I think a lot of people thought they were going to get.
Yeah, well, the Texans have had a very, very good defense. They were in the top five in defense in the NFL this year. So you know it was going to be a close game, especially with Baltimore Ravens defense. But I think the difference was Joe Flacco. He really led that team. They kind of shut Ray Rice down a little bit, but Joe Flacco did, made the throws that he had to make, didn't turn the ball over, and they're advancing.
He liked Anquan Boldin today for sure.
Oh, man. The guy made some awesome catches, man. He's getting it done. He's a tough little receiver, and he's still getting it done.
Who comes out of the AFC?
Oh, I think the Patriots do.
Got to.
I mean, yeah, that Tom Brady, again, on another level. I don't know if Ray Lewis, Ed Reeve, I don't know if those guys have enough to stop Tom Brady, slow him down. I think we might be looking at a rematch from a few years ago.
I would love that rematch. And you know what? I want to say this, too. I do not want the 49ers and the Ravens in because it's going to be all about the brother matchup. I want this Super Bowl to be about the players because it is about the players.
Exactly, and it should be about the players, and you're right. I really didn't think about it that way, but you're absolutely right. I would like to see that rematch. Don't forget, the Patriots were going for 19-0. Yeah. They were going to be the best team of all time. The Giants kind of,
They did. Yeah. They can get them back this year.
Yeah, maybe.
Lomas, thank you.
Thanks,
all right,
Katrina.
The Michigan and Ohio State hockey teams played at Progressive Field in Cleveland in the Frozen Diamond Faceoff today. The Wolverines would strike first in the first period.
Michigan controls. Player with a shot. That's knocked out of front. Brown sweeps and scores!
Chris Brown scores the first goal of the game. And then with 6:33 to go in the first, Mac Bennett fires the shot. Chris Brown follows it up, feeds to Alex Guptill, who puts it top shelf on Cal Heater for the 2-0 lead. Less than 10 to play in the second period. Here comes David Wahlberg like a freight train to the net. He just does not give up, and it goes in. The Wolverines crush the Buckeyes 4-1 in the Frozen Diamond Faceoff.
It was a lot of fun, just like last year. It was a good ending to a great weekend.
It was a great spectacle, and everyone that put that together and did a lot of work for it, I think it came off really well. It was another good one of those special events. These outdoor games are all a little different, and this was another good one.
On now to the hardwood. The Pistons were trying to make it two wins in a row tonight with the Golden State Warriors in town. First quarter, Ben Gordon has the basketball. Watch this. Going to bounce pass inside to Greg Monroe. Switches hands, lays it up and in, and the Pistons trail by one. Late in the second quarter, though, Rodney Stuckey, he's got nowhere to go. Bounces it to the big fella. Monroe draws contact and one. He finishes with 25 points, 8 rebounds, 48-44 Pistons leading at the half. But then, seconds winding down in the third, Monte Ellis stares Stuckey down and drills it. Ellis finishes with 22. The Warriors beat the Pistons 99-91. Still ahead on Sports Final Edition, Doc Emrick and Eddie Olchuk break down yesterday's Red Wings victory over the Blackhawks. Plus, Thomas Holmstrom spent some time with some 600 elementary school students this week, and he encourages education and dedication.
You got to plant that seed too and talk about it. If you don't talk about it, you know, they're not going to be aware of it.
Filppula able to guide it around behind Bertuzzi with it there. Back on to Filppula once more. Filppula, short side shot block, a rebound, he's got it!
That was Todd Bertuzzi's game-winning goal against the Blackhawks yesterday in overtime. Now, the two men that called the game, Doc Emrick and Eddie Olchuk, break down what they saw yesterday at Joe Louis Arena.
Three games have been...
Thanks, Doc. Thanks, Eddie. Still ahead on Sports Final Edition, both Michigan and Michigan State are upset this weekend on the hardwood. We're both teams, though, looking ahead to Tuesday's matchup. Plus, the NHL Winter Classic could be coming to Ann Arbor and not to downtown Detroit. We'll discuss that and more next on the show. Welcome back to Sports Final Edition, my broadcast partner and ClickOnDetroit.com sports columnist Rob Parker on the phone. I understand you had a big birthday this week, dear.
That's right, 29 again, Katrina.
All right, we'll let you keep fibbing on that one. College basketball news. Both Michigan and Michigan State lost this weekend. The Wolverines lost to Iowa 75-59. The Spartans got beat by Northwestern 81-74. Was this just a case of these two teams looking ahead to playing each other on Tuesday night?
You know what? Sometimes that does happen. I mean, especially as well as Michigan State has been playing. You know what? The big rivalry game, you're looking past opponents. It happens so often. So you know what? Could have been the case in this situation.
Okay, a hot topic here in Detroit. Next year's NHL Winter Classic will feature the Red Wings and the Maple Leafs, but will it be played in Ann Arbor and not Comerica Park? What do you think about this, Rob?
You know, I understand the NHL want to set a record with the attendance, which they can't do if it's played at Comerica Park. But, boy, the setting, downtown Detroit, you know what? One of the original six teams playing outdoors. It should be done in Detroit. I'm sorry, Ann Arbor. It just should be. And hopefully the NHL will rethink it and have it in the city where it belongs.
I'm in total agreement with you on that. I really think it needs to be in downtown Detroit. What happened today to your boy, A-Rodge?
Well, did he play? Was that the
no.
Packers?
I don't know if he showed up.
Unbelievable. You know what? First, give the Giants credit. They went up there. They won a big game. But it was just incredible to watch. And Lions fans are saying, what happened when they played the Packers? Because they played the backups and got torched, and they can't understand. But I don't know, Katrina, when you have six fumbles all year and you fumble three times in a big home playoff game, it really could have been four if the first one was called or ruled a fumble like it was.
Yeah.
They would have had four fumbles in one game, which is just amazing.
Yeah.
And when that happens, that will negate the best of players as Aaron Rodgers now knows.
Okay. Baseball news now. Joel Zamaya set to pitch against the Tigers next season for the Twins. What do you think about this move?
That's interesting by the Twins. Why not take a chance? They've done it before. You know, if the guy can stay healthy, he has a live arm. Maybe it's not what it was 3 or 4 years ago, but he might still be able to get guys out.
All right. Stay with us. Clubhouse Confidential is coming up next. It is Clubhouse Confidential time now. Click on Detroit.com. Sports columnist Rob Parker back on the phone with me. Rob, we just talked about the fact that Joel Zamaya is going to go pitch for the Twins. Are the Tigers concerned at all about facing him next season?
Katrina, my moles are telling me that the Tigers aren't that concerned. That's why they weren't willing to offer him a major league contract. But they aren't happy that he is in the division. They wouldn't mind if he was elsewhere. Mm-hmm. But to have to face him that many times is not that good.
Okay, I want to know about former Michigan quarterback Chad Henne. Is he on the move?
Katrina, my CWPS, you know, close, warm, personal friends, they tell me that Chad Henne could be heading to the New York Jets. Yes, and compete for the starting quarterback job with Mark Sanchez next season.
Really?
That's right. His former coach is now the offensive coordinator in New York, so there's the connection.
That's right. All right, what are you writing about on clickondetroit.com tomorrow?
Katrina, I'm going to write about the controversy on whether this big outdoor NHL Classic should be in Ann Arbor or Detroit, and you know it should be in the D.
I know it should be in the D. All right, safe travels, my friend.
All right, Katrina, NBC you later.
NBC you later. Up next on Sports Final Edition, one of the Red Wings teaches life skills and street hockey to a group of students. That story is next. And welcome back. This week, Red Wings forward Thomas Holmstrom spent some of his free time with some elementary students in Dearborn.
The Maples Arabic Drumming Ensemble welcomed Thomas Holmstrom to the all-school assembly. 600 students at Maple Elementary listened as Holmstrom answered questions.
Do goalies like you, and what do they say to you when you're next to the net?
No, they don't like me. They like to hit me a lot.
And demonstrated and stick then, handling.
Just feel the ball, you know, make sure, you know, you have your eyes forward.
Holmstrom's message to these children today, very simple, education and dedication.
You got to plant that seed too and talk about it. If you don't talk about it, you know, they're not going to be aware of it. So for sure it's important to talk about, you know, what to eat and stuff like that.
At the end of the assembly, five children plus Holmstrom teamed up against six teachers in a shootout.
Oh, so close. Good shot, though. Good job.
Shot after shot and stop after stop. Finally, the teacher scored.
Oh, man. Oh my gosh.
Then it was up to Homer to tie the game.
Oh, no. Right at the goal.
Well, okay, not so much. What happened on that shot?
Oh, you know, did you see that goalie?
I did.
Normally the goalies go down. I try to go top shelf. But this goalie was old style goalie, you know, like more like, I don't know.
Well, at least you didn't get slashed in front of the net.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
What did you think of today's assembly?
Mind-blowing. I think it was really great. We had fun, and I was glad that he was here.
It's so much fun to come here, and thanks for coming and see all the kids here. That's awesome.
It was fun for all of us. That is all the time we have for tonight. We thank you so much for watching Sports Final Edition. For all of us here at Local 4, have a great week and a good night.